When the H1N1 flu pandemic happened in 2009, approximately 1,500 deaths were attributed to the virus in Mexico. According to a new study, there's evidence that suggests certain social distancing measures prevented the further spread of H1N1 in that country. With me to talk about the study is Gerald Chowell-Puente, assistant professor for the ASU School of Human Evolution and Social Change. Welcome to Horizonte.
Thank you.
Your story is particularly interesting because you were involved almost from the beginning in helping figure out exactly what was going on. Tell us about that.
Yes, right. I was involved from the beginning, from in the spring of 2009, with Mexican researchers and the Mexican government, and trying to understand what was going on.
You were here in Phoenix, and you were asked to go down there and help them.
That's correct. So I flew on about mid-April to meet with Mexican researchers to try to understand what was going on by analyzing the case series data that was coming in terms of how many cases were hospitalized, how many cases were actually dying, and so forth. So the first question that we had was how transmissible this virus is, and what were the age groups that were the most affected, and how severe this was, right?
And you came up with some surprising findings.
Yes, indeed. One of the most interesting results that we found at the very beginning was the fact that the young individuals, young adults, were the most affected in terms of morbidity, cases, and mortality, which is in stark contrast with what you see during a typical influenza season, where the very young and the very old are the most affected.
Now, at some point, you determined that this was indeed a pandemic and had some connection with the 1918 influenza
yes.
epidemic that killed millions of people.
That's right. So by looking at the epidemiological data, we noticed that senior populations, the older populations, particularly those older than 60 years, were enjoying some protection. So there was more cases and deaths among young adults proportionally than older populations. And we explained that as a result of similar virus that had been circulating back in the 1950s, actually a descendant of the 1918 influenza virus that actually killed anywhere between 40 and 100 million people in the world at the time. So these older populations were enjoying some residual immunity indeed.
Tell us about some of the initial steps that the Mexican government took to deal with this outbreak.
Yes, the Mexican government quickly make decisions in terms of social distancing. They decided to close the schools in Mexico City on April 24th, so very early, when they noticed that this virus was actually spreading, being transmitted from person to person, and there was a significant number of people hospitalized in intensive care units. So they closed the schools, and they decided to close large public gatherings, cancel large public gatherings.
Such as soccer matches and so
forth. Soccer matches, close restaurants in Mexico City. And then 3 days after, they decided to actually close schools all over Mexico.
These were fairly controversial decisions.
They were fairly controversial decisions, obviously, because this is disruptive measures, and it was not clear whether this virus was going to continue causing a lot of more deaths. So the government had to make a decision, and with the data that was available at that time, and the decision was that if we are able to stop transmission by closing large gatherings, by closing schools, then we can save some time later to develop a vaccine and institute other measures as well.
And did the initial conclusions that you and your team members made in Mexico in the early days have any impact in terms of how the disease was dealt with here in the United States?
It had impact, actually. We believe it had impact all over the place because it was the same virus that was being seeded all over the world. So we suggested that resources should focus on younger populations rather than older populations from the very early data that was available. So if there is any vaccine available, the data was suggesting that young adults should receive an important resource.
And that was significant because there was a shortage of vaccines, at least in the early stages.
Right, there was actually no vaccine, and so it took about several months. It was not until actually mid-November when, for example, the U.S. had the first set of vaccines, about 40 million. So it was actually very late after the first initial waves, the first wave in in the U.S. and the after the second wave in Mexico. So this is a new virus. It takes time to develop a vaccine. It's actually made of fertilized eggs. So it took a while to have this vaccine available. Well,
given that, the slowness of developing the vaccine, the fact that this was officially a pandemic, had its roots in the 1918 global pandemic that killed millions, why didn't we have more fatalities?
Well, I think, for example, the Mexican government closed schools and made a very large campaign to make aware the population about this new virus spreading. So I think that really made a change. We found that transmission was actually reduced anywhere between 29 and 37%.
And when you say you found that, you're talking about the most recent study that
this
you did.
This is the most recent study.
To see if that worked.
Exactly.
This and is your conclusions most, were what?
Yes, that anywhere somewhere between 29 and 37% of transmission was reduced in the very early stages of the pandemic. So this potentially saved us some time.
And so this is the social distancing that you were talking about.
This is the social distancing. And the theory behind social distancing is that young individuals, particularly school-age children, have high contact rates, and also they are a lot more susceptible to influenza infection, that reducing transmission rates among these age groups can actually reduce transmission rates among all other age groups in the community as well.
Now, there was concern in the United States, even here in the Phoenix metro area, that people were overreacting, and you had schools being closed with just a few students seeming to have symptoms. Do you think that in retrospect and based upon your findings, that's legitimate criticism, that people were overreacting?
Well, it may seem like an overreaction, but when you are dealing with a pandemic virus, with a new virus that you don't know what it is, you don't know the severity and transmissibility, you have to really take decisive decisions in to take care of the population. And in this case, in Mexico, there were a significant number of young adults being hospitalized, a significant number of individuals were dying. Actually, for example, in the U.S., the first 18 women, pregnant women that got infected with the novel virus, about a third of them actually died from infection. So all these signals had to be put together in order to take a decision.
We've only got about 30 seconds left, so what's the most significant lesson learned from this experience with H1N1?
Yeah, I think in this study we learned that social distancing interventions, when they are put in place early and for a significant amount of time, in this case it was 18 days that the government of Mexico decided to close the schools, it is possible to actually stop transmission, to reduce transmission of influenza spread, and this can actually give you more time in order to develop a vaccine that could be available for later waves of infection.
And on that note, Dr. Chowell-Puente, we'll end our interview. Thank you for joining us on Horizonte.
Thank you very much.